Hey guys, welcome back. In this video, we are diving deep into Kafka's architecture. Not just what each component does, but how it all fits together to handle massive scale, real-time guarantees, and fault tolerance. Ever wondered how massive companies like LinkedIn and Netflix stream billions of messages in real time without missing a single event? That's Kafka at work. How does Kafka route messages fast? What keeps them in order even when broker crashes? And how does Kafka guarantees no data loss even if two of your broker fails? By the end, Kafka won't just make sense. It will become a tool you can engineer around with confidence. Let's decode the core component of Kafka. Imagine this. Your app is collecting transactions, user clicks, or events from sensors. How does all that data flow? It starts with the producer. This is any app or service that sends data into Kafka. It could be your backend, frontend, or even another data pipeline. The first thing that a producer does is choose a topic. Think of it like a labeled channel, where all related messages are grouped together. You might have a topic for user signup, one for orders, and another for payments, and so on. But hold on, before any messages go flying in, something important has to happen. Kafka has to set up the topic. When a topic is created, you usually specify two things: the number of partitions and the replication factor. Think of partition as lanes of highway. The more lanes, the more parallel traffic you can support. And replication factor, that's your insurance. How many backup copies you want if something fails? Let's walk through an example. Suppose you create a topic called orders with three partitions, a replication factor of 2. Now Kafka needs to create a total of 6 partition replicas. That's 3 leader and 3 follower. Each partition has a primary broker, the leader, and the replica, the follower, stored on a different broker. Kafka then assigns these partitions across the brokers in your cluster, automatically updating its internal metadata so that any producer or consumer knows exactly where each partition lives. Let's say your app wants to send an event to the order topic. The Kafka client first asks the cluster for metadata, like what partition exists for this topic, who is the leader for each partitions, and so on. Once it has this info, the producer has to make a choice. Which partition should the message go to? Kafka provides 3 strategies. The first one is round robin. If you don't specify a key, Kafka distributes messages evenly. Key-based routing. This is the second one. You provide a key like user ID or order ID, and Kafka hashes it to always send related messages to the same partition. And the third and last one is the manual. You can explicitly choose the partition, but this one is rare in practice. Let's bring this to life. Suppose you are building a real-time fraud detection system for a bank. Every time a customer does something like swipe a card, make a transfer, or page online, your app sends a transaction event to Kafka. Now imagine, a customer ID 789 makes the following transaction: page 200 on Amazon, withdraws 5000, sends 1500 via UPI, auto debit for 3000 in EMI. If Kafka randomly assigned this to different partitions, your fraud detection system might process them out of order. You could trigger a fraud alert too late or miss a fraudulent sequence entirely. That's why you use customer ID as the key. Kafka ensures all messages with the same key go to the same partitions, keeping the order intact. In fact, in finance, e-commerce, billing, and IoT, orders matter a lot. Key-based routing makes sure you get it right. Behind the scene, Kafka batches messages before sending them, either based on size or a timeout. Once ready, the batch is sent to the partition leader. The broker appends it to the segment file and append-only log and assign each message a unique offset, kind of like line number in a notebook. Offsets are bookmarks. They let consumer pick up exactly where they left off. If replication is enabled, the leader also forwards the messages to the follower broker, who write them to their own logs. Once follower confirms the write, Kafka can send the acknowledgement back to the producer. But what exactly an acknowledgement is? And why does it matter? An acknowledgement, also known as ACK, is a signal from Kafka saying messages received and safely written. The number of acknowledgements the producer waits for it to controlled by ACK setting, which defines Kafka delivery guarantee and impacts both reliability and performance. ACK equal to 0, that is fire and forget. The producer doesn't wait for any acknowledgement. This is fastest, but if the broker crashes, the data is lost. ACKs equal to 1, waits for the leader. The producer waits until the leader writes the messages to disk, offers a good balance between speed and durability. ACKs equal to all, wait for all in sync replicas. The producer waits for every in sync replicas to acknowledge. This is the safest option, ideal for financial, inventory, and mission critical system. Now let's break down a Kafka message. Each one includes a key used to decide the partition, the value. This is the actual payload, maybe in JSON, protobuf, text, or any format. Headers, optional metadata like version, correlation ID, or environment. Use keys for writing, values for business logic, headers for observability and tracing. Now let's talk parallelism, one of Kafka's superpowers. Say you have a topic with three partitions and a consumer group with three consumers. Kafka assigns one partition to each consumer, and they can all process messages at the same time. That's parallelism in action. Need to process millions of messages? No problem. Just scale your consumer, more partition equal to more parallelism equal to more throughput. And it's not just consumers. Multiple producers can write in parallel to different partitions too. Each partition is independent, so consumers can read at their own pace without blocking orders. That's how systems like Netflix, Uber, and financial exchanges stream data in real time. Internally, Kafka stores data in segment file, usually 1 GB, plus index file for fast lookups. When a segment file is filled up, Kafka rolls over a new one. Kafka also supports log compaction, where only the latest message for each key is retained. This is perfect for user state, inventory counts, or configuration updates. Now let's flip to the other side, the consumer. While producer pushes data in, consumer pull it out. They control when to fetch messages and how fast to process them. Each consumer tracks offset to know where it left off. And if something goes wrong, you can roll back and reread. Kafka also supports consumer group to scale horizontally. Each partition goes to only one consumer in the group. If there are more consumers than partitions, some stay idle. If more partition than consumer, Kafka balances them across consumer. Think of consumer groups like a fleet of delivery trucks. Each one gets its own route, making sure no two trucks deliver the same package. When a consumer joins or leaves, Kafka triggers a rebalance. This shuffles partitions assignment to maintain balance. Newer features like incremental rebalance or sticky assignments make this process smoother. Consumer can also choose when to commit offsets, letting you control exactly when a message is considered processed. Okay, so now let's talk about durability. Kafka ensures high availability using replication. Every partition has one leader, one or more follower. The leader handles all reads and writes. Follower replicate from the leader in real time. Followers that are caught up are called in-sync replicas, ISR. Only ISR can become the new leader if the current one fails. If leader crashes, Kafka promotes a follower from the ISR list to a leader. No data loss, just a fast switch. Most production cluster uses a replication factor of 3. That means even 2 broker crashes, your data is still safe. Kafka also supports unclean leader election, letting an out-of-sync replica become leader. But this is dangerous and usually disabled. What about security? Kafka offers TSL, encryption for secure communication, SASL for authentication, ACLs for fine-grained access control, audit logging for compliances, and observability, absolutely. You can track your consumer lag, monitor broker health, detect under-replicated partition, visualize with Prometheus, Grafana, or Confluent Control Center. Now let's talk about brain behind all this. Historically, Kafka used ZooKeeper to store metadata, broker, topic, partition, leader, and more. But it came with a baggage, extra setup, complex failure recovery, slower leadership election. So Kafka switched from ZooKeeper to KRaft, Kafka's raft-based metadata mode, introduced in Kafka 2.0 and now the default in 3.5+. KRaft eliminates ZooKeeper entirely. Kafka now manages its own metadata internally using Raft consensus protocol, simplifying operations and speeding up leader election. So that's Kafka. Not just a messaging queue, but scalable, durable, real-time data streaming platform that powers some of the biggest systems in the world. You have now got the tools to think beyond the basics and start designing Kafka-powered system like a pro. In the next video, we will go hands-on creating Kafka topic, inspecting partitions and replications, and watching how Kafka handles failovers in real time. And later, we will build a real-time project. I am Ved, and this was Kafka Decoded. If you want to keep leveling up your Kafka skills, make sure to subscribe so you don't miss what's coming next. That's it for this video. Till then, stay curious and keep building cool stuff.